Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is April 30th, 2016.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome as we celebrate the third Sunday of Easter. A special welcome to our visitors. If you're near in the Springfield, Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John's a new church home. This being an all communion Sunday, you will need your hymnal for everything except the last hymn. The last hymn today is printed on the back of your bulletin, but for everything else, you need to take the red hymnal out. And that's at this time, you turn to page 94 in the front of the worship book. And I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may live like in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship with God, the Ever-Great Redeemer, hymn number 618 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 618.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. This is the third Sunday of Easter. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. We're celebrating Christ is with us. He is risen. And this is what we base our faith on. We have everlasting life. This is April the 30th, 2017. Our opening hymn is Guide Me, Great Redeemer. Text is by William Williams, who lived 1717 to 1791. Ancient, old hymn. We honor it.
Thank you.
please turn to page 203 on the front of the worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Save yourselves from the corrupt generation, so those who baptized. And that day, about 3,000 persons were added. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Right beside of him. He is here with us. Two or three are gathered together. Listen to Jesus reading the gospel, his gospel, along with Pastor Pollock.
He asked him, "What things?"
They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was a wonder and a measure. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself and all the scripture. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord is arisen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had made known to them, how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. Of course, the garage sale begins on Thursday from 9 to 5, and Friday from 9 to 5, and Saturday from 9 till noon. They will be set up tomorrow and Tuesday. We have to close for the election. And then Wednesday, we will need as much help as we can to finish setting up the rest of the gym once the voting is over. And then, of course, Thursday morning, as I said, it will open. So thanks to everyone who has donated items to the garage sale to this point, and for those of you who have been working to set it up and so forth. And I hope that you will come by the garage sale and find a bargain. Also, you may have seen in the paper this morning, but Alfred Wilcoxon, who knows in the kitchen was Alfie, passed away on Thursday. His visitation will be Wednesday night from 6 to 8 at Richard's Rath in Dunbar Funeral Home, and then the funeral will be 1 o'clock on Thursday. I will be officiating the funeral. So those of you who remember Alfie from working in the kitchen with him on Kiwanis days, Tuesdays, and rainbow table on Fridays, at other times, and always tell us about how wonderful the St. Louis Cardinals were, hunting turtles in Illinois as a kid. Please remember his family in your prayers, and if possible, stopping by the visitation or being at the funeral on Thursday. Ask now that if you give your attention to the praise band.
Thank you.
Also, I, even though I was lazy just now, set the chair instead of going back down my chair, I'm happy to tell you that this is the first time I stand before you without any kind of pain in my back or legs since probably being pastor here 17 years ago. I had a shot on Tuesday, and of course, like anything, I heard all kinds of horror stories, I heard all kinds of good things. You go on the internet, of course, you have to believe everything on the internet. I heard all kinds of things on the internet, and it was a great night. I didn't feel a thing, and by the time I was halfway home, I had no more pain. So I did another shot in 3 weeks, and then they will decide whether I need a third one or they're going to leave it at that and see how I do. Amazing to be here this morning and to not have any pain, yes, going up down the steps or staying here. Anyway, so as I said, thanks to Jesus and the medical community that he enables to develop such treatments. Yes. Suddenly you don't have pain, you're almost afraid to walk because you're afraid to pray about it. It's like, don't bend, don't twist, don't step on it. Okay. To our servant, an encounter with Jesus. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you wish to have an encounter with Jesus? Or do you think that such an encounter is impossible since he is now risen and ascended, sitting at the right hand of the Father, waiting to come again to judge the living and the dead? Maybe you have a tendency to agree with a quote contributed to the first man in space, Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, who supposedly said when he returned from Earth that there must not be a God because he didn't see him while he spun around the Earth. Well, it has since been discovered that Yuri Gagarin never said that. Yuri Gagarin was actually a Russian Orthodox. Before he went up into space, he had his oldest daughter baptized, and the rector or priest for the Orthodox Church where Yuri Gagarin lived said that his family made it a point always to be in church at Christmas and Easter, and other times if possible, because Yuri being in the Soviet Air Force and the space program kept him away from home a lot. So who actually said that was Nikita Khrushchev, who in a speech before the Communist Party, bragging about Russia's anti-religion campaign, said we sent a cosmonaut into space and he didn't see God, so it must not be him. So it wasn't Yuri. But that attitude, that idea, if we don't see God face to face, then he must not exist, is still around, and such an attitude prevents you from having an encounter with Jesus Christ. If you do not believe it's possible to have an encounter with Jesus Christ, then you need to once again hear our gospel lesson for this morning. Two of the disciples of Jesus, not evidently the original 11, two of the original 11, but two other followers. Remember, St. Paul tells us in Corinthians that there was 120 and then there was 500, and he names these other groups of Christians that followed Jesus before his crucifixion and resurrection. These are evidently two of those type, and they're walking to Emmaus, which is a little village 7 miles northwest of Jerusalem, evidently their home. And as they're walking, they are in an intense conversation. They are convinced that now it is impossible to have encounter with Jesus because Jesus has been crucified and has been buried. Jesus is dead. Jesus is buried. Nothing that was supposed to happen has worked out like they had planned. All their hopes have been shattered with the crucifixion and burial of Jesus Christ. And so now they walk those lonely 7 miles to Emmaus, totally oblivious to anything that is happening around them. So the two men leave the other followers in Jerusalem, going to Emmaus, and as they are walking, their conversation is so intense, events of the past day that they don't realize a stranger has caught up with them. That a stranger has caught up with them and is walking up beside them and listening to their conversation. Middle Eastern etiquette of the day said that the two men were supposed to invite the stranger to walk with them and to engage in their conversation. But they are so busy talking that they don't notice Jesus. And this is the first way you miss an encounter with Jesus. And as we look at the story this morning, there's going to be three ways you miss an encounter with Jesus, and there's three ways in which you can have an encounter with Jesus. So this is the first two ways that you miss an encounter with Jesus. By having your mind set solely on the events of the day and the worries of the world. When you're your mind is too much focused on worldly events, when it's too much focused on the events of the day, when it's too much preoccupied with the worries of the world and what's happening, you miss an opportunity to have an encounter with Jesus. Jesus could be standing right beside you to have a conversation with you, and spiritually, and you wouldn't know it because your mind is not focusing on the spiritual. The two men fail to realize the stranger is there until he actually violates Middle Eastern etiquette by taking the initiative and speaking to them first, asking them, "What are you discussing?" The word "discussing" literally means, "What are you pitching back and forth?" It's the imagery of pitching a ball back and forth with someone. Or, as became popular in the late 60s and 70s, even to pitch a frisbee back and forth with each other. So that's what Jesus is saying. Their words are going so fast, it's like they're pitching a ball back and forth. And of course, if you pitch a ball with someone, that's something you have to concentrate on. Because if you don't concentrate, then the ball is going to hit you in the face, or in the shoulders, or in the arms, or in the legs, or someplace else you don't want it to hit you. And so you got to concentrate. So these guys are concentrating so much in their conversation that they don't notice Jesus and barely hear his question. So they stop from their serious game of words and looking at Jesus with their faces all gloomy, dejected, despondent, and sullen, and have really no mind, no matter what etiquette says. They have no mind to converse with a stranger. However, Jesus' question stuns them so much that the one identified as Cleopas has to respond. Responding in disbelief, "Are you the only person in all of Jerusalem who doesn't know what happened?" In other words, what Cleopas is asking Jesus is, of course, Cleopas didn't know about this at that time. But looking at it from our perspective, he's asking Jesus, "What are you, the first Rip Van Winkle? Have you been asleep for years not knowing what's going on? Or did you just come out of a coma? Or did you party from Friday to Sunday so you were passed out the whole time? You don't know what's going on. Everybody knows what happened. How can you be the only one that doesn't know what's going on?" And so then Cleopas explained the situation to Jesus. Oh, everybody's talking about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, who was great in the eyes of God and the people. He did all these wonderful things, but our religious leaders handed him over to be crucified. And he was crucified and buried. And now we hear these strange tales about the tomb being empty. And then he says the real problem. He says we hoped that he would be the one to redeem Israel. Now, when we see the word "redeemed" in the New Testament, in the Gospels and in the letters, it's usually in a positive way, meaning buying us back from sin. It's a word that's connected to the Roman slave market, in which a slave for sale, a person could pay what was called a redemption price. That is, they would pay a amount of money to buy the man's freedom, not buy him to be their slave, but to buy to set that person free. But when Cleopas uses it here, he's using it in a way that it wasn't intended, because just like day, they had a misconception of what the Messiah was all about. They had a misconception as to what it meant for the Messiah to come and redeem Israel. And of course, as you can imagine, it's because Cleopas is thinking politically, worldly, and not spiritually. This is probably why the majority of the people screamed for Barabbas, and why it wasn't hard for the high priest and his cronies to get the crowd to do it. Because in their mind, the Messiah was supposed to be a new David, a military Messiah, one who would come and drive the Romans out of Israel and send them back across the Mediterranean to Rome. And that Israel would now be set up as a new kingdom, as the crown jewel of the Mediterranean world, and would enjoy all this glory. And so Barabbas had tried to lead an insurrection against the Roman occupation. He had failed. That's why he was going to be crucified. And so now getting a chance to have him free again to launch another rebellion, it's better than having this Jesus of Nazareth who said, pray for your enemies, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you, turn the other cheek, and said, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and said nothing about revolution or reestablishing a political kingdom. And so because this was the misconception about Jesus, looking at him politically, they could not understand the events. Which brings us into the second reason why you miss an encounter with Jesus. And that is because you do not want to accept Jesus on his terms, but on your terms. Cleopas wanted Jesus to be a warrior king. Jesus is a spiritual king. Jesus saves us not from occupation by a foreign power. Jesus saves us from sin, death, and the power of the devil. Jesus is not a political king who rewards us with those things material that vanish and are stolen and decay and corrupt and disappear, but instead gives us those treasures that are forever, that forgiveness, that eternal life, that fellowship with him and with God forever. And so you may be missing out on an encounter with Jesus because you're not looking at Jesus who he really is. You want Jesus to be the sugar daddy who gives you a new car, who gives you spending money to go spend anytime you want, who enables you to take that promotion you've always wanted, to always be the winner, to always be the victor over your foes. That's not the Messiah of Holy Scripture. When you fail to recognize the Messiah for who he is, then you're losing out on the most important aspect of life, which is the spiritual, which is redemption from sin, death, and the devil. That is what is more important than a new car, spending money, that promotion, always being victorious over your foes, always winning every contest. Those things, as I say, disappear or forgot. I mean, how many of you today who are old enough remember Yuri Gagarin until that was brought his name? First man in space, way back in 1961, whatever it was. You know, one spin around the Earth, followed in by John Glenn, who made three orbits around the Earth for us. You know, things like that fade in the past, but redemption doesn't. Salvation doesn't fail. Eternal life is eternal life. Forgiveness washes the slate clean. So you miss an encounter with Jesus when you try to make Jesus be the Messiah you want and not the Messiah he is. So then after Cleopas speaks, Jesus responds by referring to the man as foolish. The word translated as foolish means to be without sense, talking intellect, not money sense, brain sense. It means to not understand something. It means to be slow of heart, or it means to be slow in comprehending an act. So the followers of Jesus were slow to comprehend what Jesus was doing. even though he had warned them for 3 years. Even though from the very beginning he said that they would come and he would be handed over to evil men to suffer and to die for the sins of the world, they just fell on deaf ears. They didn't want to hear it. They were too caught up in all the glory they thought they were going to have. And so then, after asking them, did not the Christ have to suffer? That phrase means, wasn't it necessary? Wasn't it necessary that the Christ come and suffer for the sins of the world? Well, if they'd known Scripture, they would have known the answer was yes. So since they don't realize this, Jesus begins by giving them a walking Bible study. Beginning with Moses and going through the prophets, he shows them how the Messiah had to die for the sins of the world, that it was necessary. And this is the third way you miss an encounter with Jesus, in that you do not know the Word of God, or you have a lack of understanding of God. If you understand God's Word, you know that Jesus fulfills all the prophecies of God's Messiah. You know that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. But if you're weak biblically, you're like Cleophas and his buddy on the road to Emmaus, not realizing it was necessary, not realizing that Jesus had to do all that he did. So those are the three ways that you miss an encounter with Jesus. So now, how can you have an encounter with Jesus? The first is the exact opposite of the last one. Last one is not having an understanding of Scripture. The first way to have an encounter with Jesus is by studying God's Word, is by having a knowledge of God's Word. To have an encounter with Jesus, you have to listen to preaching, to have Bible study, to have Sunday school classes, to read the Bible on your own, to take time to meditate. Because when you read the Bible, you're not reading just any book. When you read the Bible, you're not reading just another one, but you're reading one that is unique and different. You're reading the living Word of the living God, the living Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't have a Word, then you miss out on that encounter with Jesus. Just think the difference between reading the New Testament and encountering the resurrected Jesus Christ and reading, say, the philosophy of Plato. You don't have an encounter with Plato. All you have is have an encounter with the words that Plato supposedly said. Or you can read the Quran. You don't have an encounter with Muhammad. You just have a record of what Muhammad claims he was told to write down. But you don't have that power of the Holy Spirit behind the words that you're reading and make them alive. You make you have that encounter with Jesus Christ. So you want an encounter with Jesus, you start with his Word. Receive it any way you can, all the ways you can. So turn to his Word. Now, the Bible study's over. They've come to Emmaus. Jesus acts like he's going to walk on, and the disciples invite him to stay for the night. Stay with us, because the night is nearly here. Remain with us. Dwell with us. Abide with us. That's what the word stay means. They realize there's something special. Even though they still don't know it's Jesus, they know there's something special about this person. Because they want him to be part of them, abide with them, dwell with them. So they go in and they sit down. Jesus takes bread, blesses it, and breaks it, and they recognize it's the risen Lord. And with that, Jesus vanishes. And they get up and they run back to Jerusalem to share the good news with the 11 and the others. St. Luke, as he writes the Acts of the Apostles, throughout that book uses the term breaking of bread to refer to the Lord's Supper, to refer to Holy Communion, to the Eucharist, to the sacrament of the altar. This is the way, second way you can encounter Jesus Christ, is through participation in communion. As I told Greg this morning, when I first arrived, I said, I can't think of any other gospel lesson outside of the gospel lessons that actually describe the institution of the Lord's Supper. But, so I can't think of any other gospels that scream so much for to have communion than today's gospel lesson, and we're not having communion. I said, I've been thinking I should have held this lesson back for next week, and then next week's this week, since we're not having communion. But it's a screaming out to us that the way the church has fellowship with the risen Lord Jesus Christ is when it comes together at the table, taking ordinary bread and wine, and becoming the body and blood of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And there in that act of communion, whether you're kneeling at the communion rail or standing, or whether you're doing communion by intention, or whether you're doing communion where you just come down and keep walking, you go from station to station, and continuous communion, that's what it's called. Whether you're doing that, but no matter how you're doing it, when you take communion, you're having an encounter with the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. That's why it's so important for communion to be offered as often as possible. Because you never know on a Sunday that someone might be there, and when you're not having communion, and they're not going to be able to be back when you're having communion for 4 or 5 weeks due to their job. Or maybe they're a farmer and they've got to get the harvest down into the field. So you don't want to deny that person the opportunity to have that encounter with the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, as my dad always said, if anybody wants communion, and it's not coming up that Sunday, or and not scheduled for a weekday service order, they can always call the pastor up and ask the pastor if they can come in and be given communion. And that is an option. Or come to the house and give you communion. But it's important that we commune because we encounter the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. And the third way we encounter Jesus is his fellowship. Remember, Jesus said, whether two or three are gathered in my name, I am there with them. We have two followers of Jesus, there with Jesus, having fellowship. People ask, do I really need to come to church to be a Christian? And when we look through the history of the church, there have been some famous Christians who were hermits who lived off by themselves. St. Jerome, translated the Bible into Latin. Simon Stylitus. Another early theologian of the church went out and lived on some rock formation, you know, away from everybody. But the intent of Christianity was to be a community. As we read in those first two chapters of the book of Acts, how the people gathered together, and they would listen to the apostles preaching, and they would pray, and they would celebrate the Lord's Supper. And they would have fellowship in other ways. And so, worship is important to have that fellowship with one another in Jesus Christ. But not just worship. Anything the church does is an opportunity for Christians to gather for fellowship with each other. Sunday school class, Bible study, garage sale, Yuletide festival, potluck, family night, going to a play together or a concert together, or a group of Christians going bowling or fishing. Whatever activity, sewing, quilting, doesn't matter, playing cards. If you're Christians together, have this fellowship. And in that fellowship, we encounter Jesus Christ. And in that fellowship, we have the opportunity to encounter Jesus through the hungry that we feed, and through the thirsty that we give a drink of water to. And to the orphan, and to the widow, and to the stranger in our midst that we minister to. All those are ways that we have fellowship with Jesus. So it is possible to have an encounter with Jesus Christ, even though he was resurrected and ascended to sit at the right hand of the Father, to come again to judge the living and the dead. He still comes to us in fellowship through Scripture, through the Lord's Supper, through the fellowship we have with each other. And he's there with us. And we encounter him just as real as those early disciples who walked the roads of ancient Judea with him and ancient God. And so, can you have an encounter with Jesus? The answer is yes. Not only can you have an encounter with Jesus, but you can have that encounter each and every day. Often. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now sing God in His Almighty Word, hymn number 673, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 673.
St. John's Lutheran Church, we're singing a hymn, God Who's Almighty Word. We're looking at Jesus' resurrected body as he is encountering Mary Magdalene. This hymn was written by John Marriott, lived 1780, 1825, God Who's Almighty Word. We encounter Jesus through the Word, through the sacrament, Holy Communion, we face to face, and with fellowship with other people. Just like the disciples on Emmaus. And Connie Singleton. We have the acolyte who's bringing out the offering trays, and they will be received by the ushers, who then the gifts will be received from the members of the congregation. We thank Pastor Pollock for the wonderful sermon today on the road to Emmaus, telling us how we can encounter the risen Christ. God bless you who are watching this service. We pray that this will be a blessing to you, that you will encounter the risen Christ, just as Pastor Pollock said, in the breaking of the bread. This will happen when you come to service and receive the Holy Communion, when you're studying, when you're worshiping with us today. That's when you are receiving Jesus Christ. We have several announcements. I don't think you'll hear this before we have the garage sale, but we have a garage sale. It's coming right up this week, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and our picnic is August the 13th. But the main announcement, we have the drive-in service secured for us May the 28th, Memorial Day through Labor Day. Join us at the Melody Cruise Inn drive-in.
Lord of mercies, we do not know all things, but we know that you have made Christ to be our Savior, and having given us a Spirit to call him Lord, hear us and his name on behalf of all people according to their need. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Lord God, we live in a crooked world at odds with your purpose. Open our eyes to see your hand at work among us, and make our hearts burn with faith in your presence, that we may not fear but trust in you for all things. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Holy Father, our glory is fleeting, and our lives are born in the weakness of sin and its death. Give us your Son, that in him we may be granted eternal life. Sustain us in every temptation, and deliver us from every trial. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of power, reign in the powers of darkness and in the reign of war, violence, and terror. Give to us and all nations leaders who will seek peace and work for the common good. Instill in them a love of righteousness and guide them in the pursuit of justice for all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of compassion, those who suffer, cry to you in their need. Hear them and answer them with grace sufficient for all their needs. Heal the sick according to your will. Comfort all the wounded and give to the dying in your peace. You are our health and strength for this life and for eternal life. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord of hope, console the grieving in their sorrows and teach us to trust in you in every situation, that we may not be captive to fear, but live in joy and peace through the merits and mercies of Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Holy and gracious God, to whom live all who die in faith, receive our thanks for all those who rest from their labors and bring us with them into the light of your eternal presence, where sin, sorrow, and struggle no longer afflict us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty Father, we give us the joy of Christ's victory over sin and death, and help us to manifest this victory in holy, upright, and godly lives. Receive our thanks for hearing our prayers, and receive our thanks for giving us all things in him. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, we pray. Amen. Gathered in the one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship today with the hymn Redeemed, which is printed on the back of your book. Redeemed on the back of your book.
This hymn was written by Fanny J. Crosby, a blind hymn writer who wrote hymns in the late 1800s, 1890. This hymn was written, Redeemed by the Blood of the Lamb. We're redeemed. We have an encounter with Christ. We've had an encounter with Christ through our service today. Fanny Crosby wrote around 200 hymns a year after she committed herself to writing hymns. She was blind, divorced, lost her first child, went through all these tragedies, lived to age 95. And even in her last years of life, she wrote 50 hymns a year, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
No language, my rapture can tell.
watching us on YouTube. We invite you to come and worship with us. We'll be worshiping at 8 o'clock until the 28th of May. We'll start at the Melody Cruise Inn Drive-In. We'll have the 8 o'clock service where you can worship out of doors. And it's going to be there every Sunday at 8 o'clock and through Labor Day. Rain or shine, out of the doors, worshiping God and worshiping His creation. And you can come in Sunday school at 9:15. The parables class will still be operating, but we will have, won't have regular Sunday school, but some of the Sunday school classes will meet, some not. It's at 9:15 Sunday school, and that will be every Sunday. Then at 10:30 is every Sunday, the 10:30 service, no matter what. But the news is that we have the drive-in service again. God is providing the Melody Cruise Inn drive-in. You can come and worship as you are in your car. Today we have the flowers given by Harvey Baker and Sally Baker and the kitchen crew. We'll have live flowers, again, showing the great goodness of God. We're here meeting together. We have an encounter with Christ. Christ is there knocking at the door. He is with us every minute. We're thankful that He died on the cross. We're redeemed. We can be with Him through now and through eternal life. He can be with us. We can have an encounter with Christ as we have Holy Communion. We read the Bible. We go to Bible study. All of these things are available to you. So come to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is the third Sunday of Easter, April the 30th, also my daughter's birthday, Susan Ayers, her birthday today, April the 30th. I remember when she was born. Beautiful gift from God. Just as we sang today, we're redeemed. We have all these ways that we know that God is with us. We have encounters with Christ. This hymn, Redeemed, is based on Job, very old part of the body. I know my Redeemer lives, and we know our Redeemer lives. We are bought back. We have original sin. Jesus is with us. He's with us every day. We have an encounter with Him. Through Holy Communion, we receive Him face to face. We are with Him. He is with us. We're a part of one another. We're all a part of the body of Christ. We invite you to come worship with us anytime. And I'm your announcer, Dr. Sally Abbott, your videographer, Linda Fox, assistant videographers, James Pompoustis and Karen Dietrich. We all are happy to bring you the video. Please share this video with other people on your computer. Get more people evangelized. Let other people know that they can have an encounter with Christ. What a wonderful thing. We are able to share this. God gives us the power to share it. So let us share it through the video, through Pastor Pollock's sermon, through worshiping, and you can have an encounter with Christ. Every time you watch this service, you can have an encounter with Christ.